Assalamu alaikum. Good morning, everybody. I know today is Friday and everybody is tired yesterday from very long day, but we'll try to go through quickly about this topic, which is very deep and very comprehensive. But first of all, I'd like to thank Dr. Wasan for inviting me to give this keynote speech. I'd like also to thank Dr. Mukhtar for his introduction. So we can start by this video, if you allow me, please. What is biometric? So we get some flavor about what is biometric.
Welcome to the Spearbank IT Help Desk. Please say your name.
Jennifer Clark.
Great, how can I help you?
Password reset.
Okay, to verify your identity, please say, at Spearbank, my voice is my password.
At Spearbank, my voice is my password.
Great, your identity has been verified. Your new temporary Windows password is A4.
Okay. So this sounds like Alibaba and the 40 thieves. We have a long story in, from the Arabian Nights that Alibaba used to open the door, or he gets this clue how to open the door by saying open sesame. So now his identity has been verified through his voice. So this is something long, we know about this, people can verify, but it has been automated nowadays and people can use it comfortably instead of using password or BIN numbers or tokens or other stuff. So what we have today is just some comprehensive overview about the field, and we start from bottom up. We talk about different forms of human authentication and identification. We talk about biometrics, what is biometric and different types of biometrics, and requirements to have some good measures for biometric. And then we'll talk about different applications and use cases worldwide. Then we'll talk about market trend driving factors. And we have some system design factors and main components about biometric systems. And then finally, we'll talk about performance errors and the challenges facing this field. Then we'll talk about multi-model biometric, when we combine different biometrics, like what we hear yesterday about augmentation or fusion of different measures to get more data from different sources. And then at the end, we have some about publication venues and the concluding remarks. So let's start by saying, how can we identify each other? We have different ways people to identify people. So through his voice, through his face, through his way of walking, we can identify people. But the point is how machines can verify human. That's user identification. Not client or not machine to machine identification. So we need the machine to identify a human through some signals or some patterns that we take from the human. So we used to do this different types of authentication. Something we call knowledge based, which the user has something he knows, like password or BIN number, and he has to enter it in order for the machine to identify that this is user X. Another thing is through possessing something. You have, you own a card, you own a passport, and then you present this card or this passport to either to the machine or to the human to verify the person. Nowadays, we hear about e-passport. So the passport can be scanned by the machine, and the machine will automatically process the information. The other thing is biometric. Biometric has two different flavors of biometric, something they call static and dynamic, or some physiological aspects, and the other one about behavioral aspects about the human. So this is about what you are. This is your ID-based identification or ID-based recognition. So in brief, we have three different knowledge-based and ID-based and object-based. These are the main ways for the machine to identify a human. These are some examples for password, for token-based, for human, like fingerprint, for signature, and gate. These are different flavors for a machine to identify or to recognize a human. This field has been there for maybe, we can say, since 1975, since FBI digitized the fingerprint. So fingerprint has been used before, and usually a human being will investigate the fingerprint to identify the person. And they used to have very large cabinet to keep track of all these fingerprints. But in 1975, this all been digitized. So now it can be processed by machine, and we have something they call it AFIS, Automated Fingerprint Identification System, which is used by FBI. But the field is evolving, and people have tried since then different types of modalities and different types of characteristics about the human being. Can we use a face? Can we use a voice? Can we use the heart signal? Can we use any different part from the body to recognize the human? So it's now more than a fingerprint. We have different types of prints or different type of clues that can be used to identify the human through these physiological behavioral aspects of the human being. These are different terminologies they use, biometric. Some people, they mean by it biostatistic, and some people mean by this, the measurable items that we use. And finally, we use as automated systems that we use to do identification. So this is what we focus on, automated process to recognize a person based on some criteria or characteristic of his body or his behavior, the shape or the appearance of his body. So why biometric? Why we need biometric? Isn't it enough to use password, the smart cards, and passports, and things like this to identify human? Usually when we design authentication system, because this is the front end to identify, and based on this, we do authorization, we do on this accounting, we give either a service or deny access to a service. So this is the front end in security. We have to do security for a human by identifying or recognizing him first. So why should we rely on something like biometric? There are three criteria usually we look at, or main criteria we look at when we design an authentication system. Like for example, can we guarantee the level of security required? And nowadays we hear a lot of hacks and a lot of hacking attacks here and there, whether on physical properties or on on the cyber world. So this means what we used to do using password or using smart cards is not enough. We have to have more reliable measures that can identify and authenticate a person. So with the increase of attacks and terrorism that we hear about, we need to have more reliable, more robust measures to identify and recognize a human. The other thing we look at, is it feasible to integrate with existing systems? And we might be able to design the best system in the world, but when it comes to practicality and use it, it will have many constraints. Either it's not easy to integrate with existing system, or it's very expensive, we cannot purchase and we cannot deploy. So we have something to be easy and to be, and it can be implemented very easily and integrate with other existing systems. The other thing is about convenience and user acceptance. Again, we might have different ways to do this, but is it acceptable by the user? Is it user-friendly? The system has to be somehow accepted by the user. So if we look at the password and compare it against this, we'll see that password is not comfortable for many people because they have to keep so many different types of password. So we can see nowadays we have biometric means identity, and if you do identity or identification, you can have security as well as personalization or customization for the service provided to the user. So we don't have to keep all these type of keys. We don't have to have very thick wallets. We don't have to have so many passwords and memorize. And it's more convenient nowadays because your identity is in you. So it's more convenient. You don't remember something. You don't forget something good. You don't share it between people. It's not as easy as we do with other measures. So here maybe this one will give you the sketch, will give you some idea about what we mean by convenience and user friendly. So here we just came to the machine and say, I forgot my password, but you surely recognize me. So it's more convenient, simple, and fast to do identification. No worry about forgetting a password, no worry about exchanging or sharing a password from one to another. No regular change for password, because we know that if you have password, you have to keep changing it frequently. We have to keep password long in order to be more safe. And we have to compose a password using a certain rules. So it has to have different types of characters and so on. So it's not easy and not convenient for a human being track all these different types of accounts through password. The other thing is it's more effective and reliable, more accurate when we rely on biometric. And the third is it's more secure and harder to spoof. We nowadays hear about password cracking. It's online, there are available mini tools, you can download and use them, and they are very effective to do password cracking. Also phishing emails and phishing websites, they can collect the password and sensitive information from the user. We can also hack the system through Trojan or through some software that will, or malware, malicious software, that will be embedded in the system and do spying or collect information like key logger or whatever to collect information about the user. So when we do this, it's more secure because it's not as easy as others to spoof or to attack. The other thing, we can have unified control on the user identity and recognition. It's only through you we identify your identity or recognize your personality. It's a stronger authentication which enable new use cases and a new application. Again, more effective, cost effective, and more robust to deploy in different domains and different services. So if we talk about biometric, usually people mix between different things. So there are two different categories of biometric identification or recognition. Sometimes we mean by this verification. We need just to verify whether you are legitimate or not. Should I grant you the service or not? Should I allow you to log in or not? So it's only authentication or verification of the person. So I came to the machine and say I am X and I give my biometric. So the machine will recognize or match my record against this biometric template, and then it will identify whether this should be allowed or not. They don't know who you are, but they just verify or validate the claim you give to the machine. So this kind of one-to-one matching. And sometimes we call it suppositive because I claim I am X. So the machine has to verify that I am X or I am not X. It's only you verify it's positive or not positive. But the other one, sometimes it could be I am not. I am denying I am Mr. X. So the machine has to do negative verification. So that's called negative verify or biometric verification. Another thing is about identification. You only provide the biometric and the machine will tell you who you are. So who has this biometric? So it has to go through all the templates and do comparisons. It's kind of one-to-many comparison. But for verification, it's one-to-one comparison. So there are so many biometric traits or modalities, they call it traits or modalities or attributes that people have used and tried in order to identify. If we look at the all the days, again, as I said, they use usually fingerprint. So fingerprint is one of the very common ones in when we talk about biometric. You came to your mind that it's fingerprint. But it's more than, as I said, more than a fingerprint. There are many different things we can use through the machine. And the face recognition is nowadays very famous, usually in passport and the border crossing, they take photos and they identify the person through this. Another one is iris recognition. So the pattern we have in our iris, we can recognize the person. And these again are very famous in border crossing in some airports, they use iris recognition. The other thing about the vessel we have in the retina of the eye. So using the pattern of these vessels, we can recognize, we call it retina recognition of the human being. Also the shape of the hand, the geometry of the hand, how does it look like? So this could be a measure and used for some applications to recognize a person. The shape of the ear, so the different characteristics of the ear, we are also using it as a biometric. The dorsal, the vessels on the dorsal of the hand. So we have a pattern of these vessels, and with this pattern it can be used to identify, to some extent, to some accuracy, as we'll see later, these measures vary between different criteria, as we will see them. The other thing about palm print, so we have a signature fingerprint, we also have palm print. So there is a pattern in the palm, and we can use this pattern to recognize the person. The DNA, which is very recent, used in 1998 around, and it's used for parental forensic analysis for criminal investigation. They use DNA, and now they under investigation to generalize this and use. But the problem is hard collection of data and pre-processing of the data is not as quite as easy as other metrics. And the last one is about, or not the last one, we have also the nickel of the finger, it has some pattern which can be used to identify the person. And this use some thermo sensors to collect information either about the whole body or about the face, and they use this pattern to get information about the person. For the other one, by behavioral or dynamic, we have a signature, which is very common. We use our signatures. We also have a keystroke pattern. We have a voice, so we can recognize through, like the one we have seen in the introduction, using voice recognition. We also have the lips, the movement of the lips. We can recognize the pattern we have over there to recognize different people. And this also used in other things like recognizing language or race, so we can identify different races or different gender, the gender of the person through his lip movement. The other thing is, which is very recent also under investigation, through the way we walk. So we have a pattern when you see someone coming at a distance, you can recognize this is my friend or this is one of my family. So the way we walk has a pattern which is, again, sometimes different from one to another. We can use to, they call this gait recognition. There is another taxonomy or classification for this about inside metric and outside metric. So this is something from inside, this is something from outside. There is a more general comprehensive classification about which part of the body we are using. Is it the hand or the face or the ocular? Or the medico-chemical aspects of the person, or it could be behavioral aspects of this person. Also, they use something, these are called hard biometrics. There is also something called soft biometrics, which can be augmented or can be used with other hard biometrics to improve the accuracy or the performance of the system. Something like gender, like ethnicity, like color of the face, like color of the eye, this can be used as well to augment the source or the information about the person. There is another taxonomy about single biometric, which is commonly used. We use just one biometric to recognize a person, or multimodal biometric, which can combine or integrate more than one source and then do the analysis to have some clues from here and there and do the decision based on these multiple sources. We'll see later why this is important to integrate and to do fusion of information and at which level we do the fusion of this information that we collect. So this is some of the multimodal biometric that are combining the two or more together to get more information about the person. With mobile technology nowadays and the low processing we have in the algorithms, we can implement most of these things are implemented in mobile. And they expect by 2020, most mobile or 100% of mobile computing will have biometric identification for users. Another thing is to use 2D or 3D. So we have information in 2D and do processing, or we can have this information in 3D and they do some morphological analysis about the shape of the face or the shape of the body to recognize the person. So which modalities will be the best? We have so many different types in the body, different parts of the body. And the question will now, the natural question will be, which one of them should we use? We have to set up some criteria in order to say this is good or bad. And the criteria they use is, first of all, they have to be universal part of the body, which means everybody has this type of biometric. At least everybody within the domain under study or at the domain under recognition, he has to have this type of biometric. Another thing is about distinctiveness. So the biometric has to be distinctive, has to be unique for this person to be identified. Another thing is about longness, or it has to stay robust for some long time. It has not to be invariant, it has to be invariant for changes for a long time. So for example, if we look at the face will change from time to time. So by aging, people will have different faces, or by doing some cosmetic or whatever, it will change. So we need this to be invariant, some biometrics that will not be easy to change over some period of time. Otherwise, we have to keep updating the system, and we can easily go through and fake the identification. Another thing is about acceptability by user. So we can have different sensors to collect the information, but which sensors will be acceptable by users? Some of these are sometimes not healthy. Some of them may not be hygienic and will be refused by people to use. So we have to have some easy way to collect information from the user. For example, if we look at fingerprint, it might not be hygienic because people put in their fingers on the same place. So they might have some diseases or so, and we can have some medical problems. So we need some contactless way to collect this information. Without touching the sensor, like the face, it's easy because it's invasiveness. We can collect externally the information without any touch of the sensor. The other thing about performance, the accuracy, the speed, the time to collect this information and do enrollment or the database that we have. So we look at the performance matrix and compare between these different types of biometrics. And then we have collectability. Is it easy to collect? Can we have sensors that are easy to collect this type of information or pattern of the user? We know some sensors are very expensive, or some of them are cheap. Some of them are, as I said, healthy, some are not. So we have some way to collect this information quickly and maybe on real time in order to do quick processing for users. And then we have circumvent, which means it's not easy to temper or to change or to fake this identification. So it's robust against attacks. The biometric that we have is not easy for someone to do false identification through the machine. So if we compare these different criteria, we'll have, these are the most common ones. We have the four common ones: fingerprint, facial recognition, iris recognition, and DNA. We will see that fingerprint is used for a very long time for border control, for governmental services, for criminal investigation. But the problem here, as I said, it maybe we need to have some contact sensor to collect this information. For facial recognition, it is non-invasive, so we collect it externally. It's easy to have, and people will accept it easily to collect the photos and get their face image. But again, the problem may be here that the face will not last for a long time. It may change from time to time, as we'll see by different factors. Iris is very robust. It's not easy to fake. We cannot share iris, or we cannot have a fake iris. But the problem is, do we trust the sensor? Is it healthy to collect this information easily from the sensor? So the collectability of information might be a problem for this one. But these measures have very high accuracy. They may be reach more than 99.9% accurate in recognizing or verifying the identity of person. The DNA also is very high accurate and usually used in forensic analysis for parenthood verification or for criminal investigation, they use DNA. If we put all metrics and compare it against these different types of biometrics, we'll see these are classified as subjective, in a subjective way, as high, low, medium. So some of these, like DNA, will have high universality. It's very unique, but it's not easy to collect. As I said, we have a problem in collecting this information, so it will have low collectability. It's also not easy to fake, so it will have low circumvention. So it's not easy to timber a DNA because it's very unique and not... the air will have some medium universality because air is not very unique for different people, and maybe some people they don't have, or the shape of the air is not convenient to use for recognition. So these are high, low, medium to give you some idea about the different metrics for different biometrics. So we can say from here it's application dependent. We have to do investigation for what type of application we need to deploy, and then we can design the system based on. So sometimes we have trade-offs, design trade-offs. We may not need it very high accurate, but we need it, for example, to be easy to collect, to be real time, to be. So we may have contradicting factors, and we have to compromise something against the other. So it is application dependent, and we have to consider this under when we do the study. What type of applications or use cases we have for this biometric? In fact, it can fit any application and any domain in our life. We can use it in governmental services for border crossing. We have this implemented. For national ID, driving license, we have this implemented in some places. For airports, we have this implemented in machines and e-gates. People can go easily through the airport. We have it for restaurant retail places, for paying or payless point of sale places. We have it for corporate industry, for time marking time and attendance, taking attendance of people. We have it for healthcare and research institutes, libraries. We can implement, or it is implemented for some places. In banks, financial institutions use biometric to do recognition. So it's actually in all domains of our life, we can have biometric identification for the human. This figure will show you the places where the e-passport has been used worldwide and where it's announced to be used in the near future. So we can see most of the world in Europe, in North America, and in Australia, they implement these. In most of the other, and Africa, they did not use it or they have no biometric implemented for e-passport. How it works for e-gate or e, when we travel through the airport, how this will work. First is they verify the document that you have. So we have a machine-readable document which will be scanned by the machine, and this information will be submitted. This information will be submitted to verification. And if the document is accepted, then they read the information from the smart card, which is implemented there. Again, this information will be verified. If this person is verified and no problem against, we'll take a biometric, and this information will be sent for comparing with other people, which is like a blacklist or criminal list, to deny or allow access for this particular person. Hopefully, in the near future, we'll not see something like this in airports. It will be easygoing. We have e-gates, we have these e-passports, and we'll not see long queues, we'll not have this layout time for very long time because of delay in processing. Some use cases worldwide. This is in United Arab Emirates. In 2003, they implemented iris recognition in most of their airports. They use iris recognition, and these are some of the places where they have implemented iris. In Abu Dhabi, in Dubai, they have an international airport. Also in London, Heathrow, in Ben Gurion Airport in Tel Aviv. This is in Narita Airport in Japan. This one in Schiphol Airport in Netherlands. In the United States, we have seen these type of machines over there. The Scott Airport, they use hand geometry for accessing the system. In Amsterdam Airport, they have these machines to recognize people and identify them. There is another use case, if you could please run the. So we have smart cards.
You get into your car, and automatically, your seat and mirror positions adjust for you. Your favorite radio station begins to play, and your email and Facebook accounts open, and your navigation favorites and past destinations glow. All while having the peace of mind that no one else can access your personal data. Voice biometrics is a natural, effortless, and accurate way of authentication that makes the driving experience personal and protects drivers' data against illegitimate use. It can be implemented as a standalone identification technique or even combined with a wake-up word and natural language voice commands.
Good morning, Dragon.
Good morning, Mike. Your hotel reservation is confirmed.
The user can activate the voice dialogue, identify oneself, and speak a command, all in one simple, natural phrase.
When the car is shared by many people
using the same car, Voice biometrics is the ideal solution for personalization of car settings and making personal assistance truly personal. For example, different people speaking the same command, play my music, will expect different titles to play.
Now, find us new music.
Okay, now play some music from Andy Mack.
And a request from a passenger might be treated differently than a command from the driver. However, it's not only a matter of convenience. As cars become increasingly smarter and more connected, they provide access to email, contacts, social media profiles, music, and all kinds of content and data. Voice biometrics helps protect
So enjoy driving. No more problem in driving, and this type of biometric using a voice is more convenient for this type of application than maybe most of other types of biometric. Because it's natural to identify while you are, it's easy to talk and identify the person, and do personalization for the services provided for this particular person. These are for accessing restricted areas. So access control in restricted areas, they use different types of biometric, mostly like fingerprint or palm print or hand shape to allow people to access this area. These for some condominium residents, they can reach their flats through identification, and the elevator will have a way to identify the person, allow him to reach his residence. Another place for public places like gardens, they might have a way to identify people so they can reduce criminal to access these places. Pay by touch in some retail services or restaurants, they use this way to verify the identity and allow you to pay. Other types of sensors used for fingerprint. Okay. So these are sensors, different types, to allow you to collect information and process it. This for mobile, it's one of the very hot topic, is to do low processing in order to be able to implement and embed this in mobile technology. These are different types of sensors. This one is very recent. Maybe we can watch this, please. It's using the electrical signal of the heart or the brain signal to identify the identity of the person. So there is a bracelet, you take it, and this will measure the electrical signal of the heart. How much time? 5 minutes. So this is one of the applications, again, where we can apply a new type of biometric for signal. And another application, for example, sometimes it's hard to do biometric if we have a burglar, someone like at a bank or an institute, someone is taking money or running. He is usually hiding his face, hiding his hand. We cannot collect this type of biometric easily. So the only way you might have is the way he's walking or running. So this information will be used to identify the criminal or the robber. This one shows the trend mark for biometric, and we can see by 2022, the revenue will be like $30 billion US dollar worldwide. This one shows different types of biometric in different places of the world. And again, how much is used over time. This one shows by biometric or by trait, which biometric is more used than the other, and the trend for each. We'll see fingerprint is declining, reducing, but there are other new types that are there and used more conveniently and easy through this system. This one shows mobile biometric is booming, and we have increase in this area, and hopefully in the future, as I said, by 2020, most mobile will have embedded biometric sensors to collect this type of information and process it. This one shows different domains or different services and the sectors they have used it more than the others. And we'll see again that this in some new areas are increasing, like logical access and like surveillance and monitoring. They are using more biometrics than others. Why this is booming? Again, there are three important criteria when we assess any technology: about business case, about the technical performance, and the user acceptance. And we'll see this, most of these are there for the biometric technology to be included. There are many companies behind this, and these are some of the names. Also, some companies work in different biometrics, and some organizations, I'm not collecting, it's not comprehensive, but most of the popular ones that are working in this area, research groups that are focusing in biometrics, and these are related areas to biometrics. For the design, we look at the biometric system and how does it work. Usually we collect the data and we build some template in the database, and then when we have a new one coming, we collect the data again and we extract this type of features, then we do comparison or similarity measure between these different patterns that we have. Then we evaluate the system if it's accepted or not and make our decision. So this is a more comprehensive that will show all the components there. We start by the user, we collect the data from the user through some user-friendly sensors or interface, and then we check the quality of this collected information. We may accept or reject this information from the beginning. It's noisy or not high quality, or it's dirty or whatever, so we have to reject and collect it again. We might try this several times, and we need to reduce this as much as we can. Then after this, we do enhancement for the collected information, this type of pre-processing, and then we do feature extraction and the building template, store it in the database. Later on, if we collect this, we go through the similar process, and then we do matching between the retrieved template and the collected template, and if this score is up to a certain level, we may accept or reject this information. We might skip this one as well. There are also different modes of operation, like enrollment or registering in this first, collecting information and creating database information, and then verification phase and identification phase. So this one shows some math behind this type of... The most important part is feature extraction. When we collect this, we have to somehow reduce the dimensionality and have very few salient features that we use in the identification. Like, for example, fingerprint is used minutiae, and this minutiae will give you the location of this salient point and the direction of this point, which can be used for identification. For hand shape, they do different measurements at different places of the hand geometry, and this again about the structure or the skeleton of the hand that can be used. Another way of having this type of feature. The most important here, when you collect this information, we need controlled environment. We need somehow to have this, otherwise the information will not be valid. This one for the face, and again, the number of points and the location of the points is more important in recognizing the air, the structure of the air. So this is skeleton or structural information about the shape of the this is about the gait. We have certain joints, and we follow the changes of the joint over time. So we have a signal for each of these joints, and this will be used for the other one of the is called the statistical or texture or appearance features. And this will be like a holistic processing for the image or for the signal to get some information about. And this we use different types of transformation to process and get the data. For example, for faces, we use something very common called eigenfaces to do recognition for the people. And these are different ways for the palm print. This is for the face using the Gabor filter. This is for the fingerprint using Gabor filter. This one for the iris and the building iris code. This is for the gait.
1 minute because we want to
okay.
Have questions.
Okay. And the performance of the system, there are different errors that might appear here and there. We can skip these all. We have something important we may focus on, that some of the biometric are hard or they have face some challenges. Like, for example, face, they have this problem of inter-class similarity. We might have twins or parent and child very similar and not easy to recognize each from the other. Over time, we have this called intra-class variation. So we have, over time, the person face a change from time to time. The signature also varying, this called intra-class variation. The person might have disease or due to aging, he might have changed the way of walking. The expressions on the face, the emotion that the person have, the position of the face is also affecting this type of the cosmetic. Okay, so this just a quick.
Thank you, doctor.
Thank you.
This is really